spirits up in here tonight, y'all. We have a full powerhouse in the building. We're going to introduce, we got Mr. Caleb Castille coming in tonight, y'all. The one and only, the movie star of Woodlawn. He's one of the co-stars of NCIS Los Angeles. Down there with OLL Cool J. OLL. He down that way, man.
And Big Ellie.
Oh, yeah, Big Ellie. Man, he won two national championships at Bama, which is crazy within itself. He walked on at Bama, which is even more crazy within itself. And he'll be walking in a minute. I know he had a little traffic downtown, but he just texted me he'll be there in a minute. Then we're going to have the great Reggie Ragland on. And Reggie, right now, he's getting out of meetings, and so he'll be on pretty soon. And Mr. Antonio Langham will be in studio with us tonight. I know he's getting ready to walk in, too. And I think we're going to have some visitors coming in, too, or coming on board to give my guys flowers, man. It's just going to be very special tonight, man.
Right.
Chris, how was your weekend, man?
It was very good, sir.
I'm sorry. And we got the one and only. My sidekick, Mr. Chris, on the other side of me. How you doing, man?
Doing good. Had a great weekend. Not too much, of course. Enjoyed a great Iron Bowl and lots of football Saturday. How about yourself?
Before we get into the Iron Bowl, how was your Thanksgiving?
Wonderful. My mom cooked some wonderful food, took lots of leftovers home.
Okay, what? Because it's different. It's different now. you got two different Thanksgivings now. Hold on. What was on the menu?
Just, you know, the traditional. Got the turkey, ham, stuffing, mashed potatoes, gravy, some good collard greens.
She made them collards?
Yeah, yes.
Was it mustard collards or what was it?
I think just collards.
Okay. Did she put bacon in there or did she put turkey?
There was a smoked ham in there.
Oh, she put smoked ham?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. She from the South.
She can do it right now.
So was that it?
Let's see. I think it's green bean casserole, mac and cheese. You know, pretty much standard fare.
No potato salad.
No potato salad.
No raisins in the potato salad.
Heck no. Do not do raisins in potato salad.
Man. And what's crazy is I went and did a few stuff with friends and family and went and hit my first deer, man.
Yeah?
Yeah, with one of our sponsors for the show, man, with the Blood of Mary.
Nice. I got
Mr. Agnew Hall, man, and it's crazy because I hit my first one. The first time I tried to hit it was some years ago, and I tried to hit a deer, and it turned around. Well, I tried to hit a hog. It turned around, mm-hmm. Looked at me, laughed, flicked me off, said, ha, 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 ran around three times in a circle, started eating again,
mm-hmm.
Looked at me while I missed again, and just like, are you serious? And I'm talking about this hog was pretty big. I'm talking about, and I just, you know, guns and violence just wasn't for me, and I could tell you why. So that hog laughed at me and flicked me off.
I will say though, never be intimidated by a weapon. I mean, you know, hunting and violence and guns one thing, but hunting and guns is a whole different. You know, that's put food on the table.
So I hit my first deer this weekend, and well, not the weekend, the week. And so when I hit the deer, it jumped up. So I'm like, dang, did I not hit it?
Mm-hmm.
And it started running towards me.
Uh-oh.
It started running towards me. I'm like, what the hell is going on? And like in my mind, I mean, I can hear somebody saying, shoot it again. But in my mind, in my head, like, was just like, I know I just hit this deer. Like, why is this deer coming towards me? Then it took off and made a right. So if it was coming towards me, it made a right.
Mm-hmm.
But it'd be going to my left. And so when it made that right, it's a pond behind me, a lake behind me. So I'm like, why did it go to the lake? You know, because I'm in the hunting house. Well, what would you call it? The
shooting house.
Shooting house, yeah. And shooting house ain't nothing but a closet big for real. You can only put two chairs in there.
Yeah.
And so it's coming towards the shooting house, and then it made the right and went in towards the woods. And so I'm like, man, I know I hit this thing. Like, and that just kept bothering me. Like, so as it got dark, and I was just like, let's go ahead and go. And, you know, and so we, you know, get ready to go. And we hear some stuff behind us. And it's just like, man, what is that? And I we seen one of the deers come back past, because it was two of them.
All right.
And so we seen one go back past. Then we didn't see the other one. And so in my head, I'm like, man, that, it got to be dead. Like, it got to be. And so as we leaving, like, we hear a little bit of noise, like, moving. So I'm like, oh, man, like, something fit to get us. Like, black man in these woods out here, country woods in Lavaca, Alabama, like, this ain't supposed to be happening like this. Like, I just knew Bigfoot was fit to come out of the water somewhere. Sasquatch would have come around a corner somewhere.
He got me.
So look, we get back with our group, and mm-hmm. our group say, did you hit him? Because I called him and told him, you know, it jumped up, you know, and they said when it jumped like that, I mean, you usually hit him. And it was like, yeah, you probably hit him. Let's go find him. And it started raining.
Oh.
So you couldn't see the blood.
Right.
And then, like, you got, you know, it's really fall season for real. So you got red leaves on the ground.
Yeah. Hard to track.
It's hard to track.
Yeah.
And so I learned how to track a deer and everything out there this weekend. It was nice. Like, man, they showed me everything. And, like, we looking, and then it looked like it was blood on the ground. And I was like, nah, that's not it. But then it started, it went raining. And I was like, man. And so right behind. And so one of my little nephews, you know, they was tracking the woods and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so right behind us, we kept hearing some stuff move behind us. And when that happened, one of the boys say, I see it. And because he was flashing his phone, his uh-huh. light on the phone. He said, I see the eyes. So I'm like, it's still alive? And they was like, yeah, it's hanging on. But you hit it. You definitely hit it because it was right there by the water. They say when the deer get hit, they go towards water. And I don't know why they do that. Do you know why they do that?
I don't know. Maybe some kind of an instinct?
Yeah, they say they go towards water. And so I felt so bad, though, when I walked up on it because I had to hit it again.
Had to go ahead and finish it.
Yeah, I had to finish it off.
Yeah.
I mean, this thing was probably back there for about, because we stayed another hour after we hit it.
Oh, wow.
The first time. No, I'm saying okay. The first time. So, it was a soldier. I know that. And so on top of that, man, it was just like when I hit it again, because, you know, I'm out there really with some younger guys, too.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want to be like, oh, man, it's Trey Richardson, man. He's scared, too, man. Oh, man.
Got a man up.
Yeah, I had to man up a little bit. So I hit it again, and I feel so bad, man. And I called my youngest daughter, she loves animals.
Mm-hmm.
She's like, Dad, are you serious? You really did that? Man, I felt even worse, man. And so my boys, they enjoyed it, but my girls were like, Dad, I really can't believe you did that. Especially my youngest girl. And then I felt even worse. I mean, but man, it was fun. So after good you deal. Hit that first one, though,
yeah.
You like thirsty for it. Like, you are thirsty. Like, we was riding all down the highway and like, I think I see one. And it was dark. Like, man, it's time to go, man. I think I see one.
Funny means on hold.
Yeah, man, but it was funny, man. It was fun too, man.
Well, good deal, man. Awesome. Congrats.
Man, we got one of them hometown heroes in the house, man. Funny man, how you doing, man?
Fellas, what's going on a Monday?
Oh, man, we good, man. We talking about my deer story, man. I hit my first deer this week. And when I hit my deer, it was Friday, I think. When I hit the deer, it started charging back at me, funny.
So when you say hit, are you talking about with a vehicle or a rifle?
No, I shot my first. I shot my first. Man, you get on. I ain't doing this with you today. I'm not doing this with you today, bro. Look, funny, when I shot that thing came charging towards me. I'm like, bro, I know, and like in my head, I was stuck. So I'm like, I know I done shot this thing, bro. Like, I know.
Do you recall where on the body you shot him? That's important.
Yeah, I shot him in the shoulder, on a back. I guess it'd be the back leg, and it went through the stomach. I know. Wow. That was my first one. Man, yeah, I threw the meat up, man. So
that's you know it. They always say you got to stay away from the meat, brother.
Yeah, man, I let them have the meat, man. I go and sit down, man. I ain't mess with the meat, man. I let them have it. But I did skin it a little bit. Man, those kids down in Lavaca, Alabama, they skinned that thing in 6 minutes. Like, they were serious with
that. I can believe.
Lavaca, mm-hmm. Alabama. Like, Butler, Lavaca, Alabama. Like, down there, I'll get off York, the York exit.
Yeah, all my family from down that way, man. It's a whole bunch of towns you can't pronounce down there. All my people from Choctaw County.
Yeah, Choctaw County. There's so many names down there you can't pronounce with them towns, man.
Absolutely. You got you. But Butler, Riderwood, those are my people down there.
Well, they ain't got number 50 people down there anyway.
All them Ruffins, too. I guarantee you.
All them Ruffins.
And those are my people.
Yeah, you flip the mic over there. No, just flip the mic over this way. Man, so look, man, we Mr. Caleb Castile just came in, man, you know, the big movie star, TV show co-star. Then we got
Welcome to Hollywood, baby.
Yes, sir.
World's most addicted drug.
The one and only Tonio Langham, 1992, first round pick to the Browns, huh?
Yeah.
To the old Browns. Old dog pound, man.
Yeah. Walking somewhere with a brown shirt on the other day, and people started looking at me crazy.
Why they looked at you crazy, man?
I don't know. We ain't been relevant in a long time, I guess, but that's why. They figured we'd stop making brown paraphernalia by now. But this probably going to be my last day on the show, man, because I'm moving out to California with Caleb.
Yeah, we got him.
He got me a little spot out there, man. I ain't want to go. I won't do no acting. Acting up every day. Yeah, just gonna go hang out, man.
Enjoy Malibu.
There it is, right there.
Oh, Malibu, man. Yeah, absolutely. But I know we gotta take a quick break, real quick, and we're gonna pay a couple bills. We're gonna let Caleb do it, man, because you know he out there in Hollywood now. So we're gonna let him pay a couple bills for us and listen to some of these interesting messages. And we'll be right back with the ropes with TR3. Welcome back, everybody. So let's get into it, man. We
got everything in them.
So listen, off air, you talking about these old remedies. And Caleb, you had one grandma put on you.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a whole bunch of now?
Oh, I don't know, man. A whole bunch of beef fat, something. She called it, some type of beef fat. But, You know, the only time I didn't mind it, to be honest with you, I remember one time, a couple times in high school, I'm sick, like, leading up to the game Friday night, you know. I'm like, man, I don't want to call grandma. I need to play tomorrow, you know. So, she had that talent, man, and a little Tupperware, man, with the rag in there, heated up, put it on your chest, good to go.
Now
we just heard one.
Slide that mic to Lisa real quick.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, here you go.
Uh-huh. So, Miss Lisa,
I hate y'all.
You said something about something. Was it your grandma or your mama?
My grandmother.
Your grandmama. Mm-hmm. Put some around your neck.
Man, just get to it. Man, don't even try to set it up. Just go right to it, man.
So, Miss Lisa, what did you had the what now?
Mumps.
I got the hype man right there. Okay, had the mumps, and my grandmother used to take sardines and put them in a rag.
Ladies and gentlemen, that would be canned sardines that you could buy. You could buy at the corner store for $1 a can. You just pull, got the tab on there, you pull it back. You got about 4 or 5 of them boys in there, man. All the backbone, whole spine missing, and just a plate. That's all it is. Come on, man. Finish your story. Come on. Come on.
Oh, no.
Oh, God.
Oh, man.
So she put them in a rag and wrap them around our face because that that reduces the swelling in your face and helps to calm the fever down with the mumps.
Funny man. Funny man, don't hear.
I can't hear.
Funny man. You need some more
material. Yeah, I'm here. I'm
you
here.
Just got it then, man. She, grandmother wrapped her up in sardines, man, and wrapped her around her face. And she said she walked around the street. I said she had to went to the right corner store. Them boys put a little hot sauce on her, got some crackers. She been done dealing.
Yeah, you better believe it.
Man. But then you need
down there in Choctaw County, yeah, they'd have got you right on up out of
the
there.
The collard greens.
Funny man, you heard this one now. You want here go another one. You ready? Let's go, Lisa. Come on now.
We had a fever. They would wrap us in collard greens.
Huh? You ever heard of that?
Oh yeah, I knew about that one. I've been wrapped there. But the thing about it is, not cooked collard greens, man. It got to be the raw collard greens for y'all.
So you've been wrapped in collard greens before too.
Yeah,
I'm deep absolutely. In the country. I ain't never nobody else wrapped me in no collard greens for no fever out of me.
But this my thing.
Vindicated. It's got to be the big leaf.
Whole leaf. But this is my question. What you do with the collard greens after? Because I know y'all wasn't throwing them away.
I know they
ain't no way the black folks throwing them collard greens away. Ain't no way.
They weren't throwing them collard greens away.
It's soaking up like fever, reducing fever. You can't put collard greens in no pot like
enough,
that.
You put enough. You cook chili.
No.
You imagine everything run through chili and they put enough meat on 165 and you're fine. That's you get the temperature 165.
He know
good.
The temperature.
Yeah, he cook all that out of there.
Cook all it out.
Cook it all at 165. You good. So you mean to tell me, I bet your grandma was like, baby, don't y'all throw them collard greens. Uh-huh. Bring them on over here. We soak them in some water for a little while.
I can hear my grandma now. Baby, don't throw them collard greens out. Man, you know how much stuff my mama and Jean wanted to throw away. Jean. Throw them collard greens out.
You heard the one about the hiccups?
No, let us hear this. Because we're getting remedied today. Let me hear this one.
You know the old brown paper bags they had back in the day? He would tear a piece of that and put right here.
In the bit on your forehead?
Yeah, it's supposed to get rid of hiccup. Hey. Hey.
Well, man, we going live, baby. We going live on next Monday karaoke. We going live.
Listen, when I was growing up, they used to tell me, you got hiccups, I mean you're growing.
That's getting taller. That's another one
that's
too.
That's a Florida thing, I guess.
That's a Florida thing too. But the paper bag.
I used to try to have the hiccups for no reason.
I would call my sister.
I stopped growing.
You just forcing yourself.
You trying to, right trying here, to get up there.
Hey, you just see your wall right
here. I'm still doing it. Right. Look, my brother turned out to be 6'6". I'm 5'11", 5'10 and a half on a good day.
I can imagine your mom walk right, look at him, like, what's wrong with that boy? He walk right here acting like he got the hiccups all that. Well, mama, somebody told him he could grow. I guess what he's doing.
It was mama who told me that.
We got plenty of remedies.
Give us another one there since we all
remedies. Oh, everybody knows about this one. Like, just, we had aloe plants in the backyard, and she would peel them.
That was in Growing Town Creek.
Yeah, she would peel them and put them in a jar of purified water, let it sit overnight. Every night we had to take a shot of aloe juice. And we were hardly sick. Yeah.
Okay, let me ask you something. Was that actually aloe juice? Or was that
the collard green juice?
Was it that juice they were brewing way back off in Florida?
No, it's not moonshine, sir.
Right at the edge of the swamp.
It's not moonshine.
You're going to make it be like aloe water.
No, it was aloe. I can't sit next to you.
Oh, man.
But man, you got a remedy. You have another one. I know you heard about the collard greens. You have another one.
Let me see. What's a good country remedy? Nah, just Robitussin.
I'm over here weak. Oh man, look, man, this ain't how this show's supposed to win.
It was way left.
But I love it though,
man. My cousin. My grandma's never did this one. We from the same area. He said every time he start feeling like a cold or something, said grandma just make him swallow some Vicks.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's true.
Yeah.
Swallow big.
That's
big,
true.
Vapor rub.
Yeah.
He's
yeah.
His grandma making him just swallow something, man.
Tablespoon.
That's a new one on me.
Swallow that it,
can,
though?
That
yeah.
Can,
yeah.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yo, he all right today?
He all right today?
If I tell you who it is, you'll answer that question on your
man,
own.
You been, oh, man.
You remember my little, hey, you remember my little cousin, Jazz, the light-skinned Jazz?
Right.
Yeah, him. Man. Yeah. I don't think he all the way there right now.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I've been around you long enough to see he would affect it.
That shot of castor oil used to do it, too.
Yeah, I remember that. That
funky oil, boy. That fish oil.
Oh,
I'm gonna get everything about you.
Oh man,
that's gonna clean your pipes.
Man, I can't stop laughing, man. Oh my, listen, you know how you laugh so much and your body get weak? That's how you know I'm getting older too.
But man, I still can't get older. Sardine wrapped around.
Cause you would have went into the woods. Something would have grabbed you for real. We went. Oh, I ain't tell you about the hunting trip.
We had to stay in the house, so we couldn't go outside. And there's a reason why.
Well, they didn't want you to stay in the house with the sardine wrapped around your
face. I hate
him. Hey, funny man, tell me this: did y'all ever, when y'all was growing up,
yeah,
and they used to tell you like, if you look at somebody got the pink eye, you gonna get the pink eye?
Yes.
And so for school,
oh, absolutely,
to not go to school, I used to be at my brother eye like this. I used to be looking at his eye. Both my eyes. Mama, I can't go to school. I got a pink eye.
They said that about the pink eye catching the sky on your eye.
Uh-huh.
Pretty much anything dealing with the eye. You look at it, you're going to get it. If somebody smack you on the back while you're making a face, your face going to get stuck like that. Boy, they had a whole bunch of your thing.
Man, y'all are crazy, man.
I love it.
Y'all are crazy, man.
I'm going to call my mama today and ask her. I'm going to say, Mom, when you had the mumps or something, did they ever wrap you in sardines around your face? I can imagine what my mom would say. Wouldn't have told you that.
Yeah, I'm going to call Trina and ask her.
Yeah.
I'm going to call Coach. I'm going to call your dad and ask him about
that. Yeah, man. I imagine my dad had some
man.
Boy back when,
he used to tell him about the stuff that your grandma used to do.
Yeah. Look, my grandma, you gotta think about it now. So, my grandma married Castile, born and raised in Phoenix City, Alabama, back country.
Oh, yeah.
You know? But what most people who met my grandma don't realize is when she would turn 55 and Tim was born, my oldest brother, my grandma Mary was a raging alcoholic. And cold turkey went sober.
Yeah. I remember this story.
Man, listen, Mary Castile, she used to tell Phoenix City up, boy. She used to tell Phoenix City up, and her drink was whiskey. She was a whiskey drinking woman. So
grandma was built for it.
So you know what that means. She liked to fight.
I bet grandma throw them hands too.
Big time.
She throw the boy, man. She two piece of dude right out the shot.
Man, my dad used to tell stories, bro, about, you know, everybody used to wonder, like, you know, my dad a real quiet guy, right?
Right.
And, you know, when he was growing up, it was like, everybody knew his, you know, it's like, you know, he carried a lot of shame, though, because it's like, your mom was a town drunk,
right?
You know? And he used to tell these stories, man, about him being 10, 11, 12 years old, and him and my granddaddy having to go and get my grandma up out the bootlegger house. 10, 11 years old.
Yeah.
Go and get your mama out the bootlegger house, man. But, you know, it's funny, though, because that's a version of my grandma I ain't know.
Yeah.
You know.
You got the sweet side.
Yeah.
Man, this the best story I ever heard in my life. My uncle told me this, man. To this day, I don't believe him. But I love him too much. Funny, man, you're going to like this. Town Creek, North Alabama, up by Muscle. My uncle said that his granddaddy was best friend with Frank and Jesse James. They used to ride through there every year, and they stopped by the house and talked to him.
No way.
I walked out of my house. He was visiting me. I walked out of my house, man. Man, Frank and Jesse James, they were all on West Coast, man. You think they rode a horse from California all the way to Alabama, man? Come on, man. Really? He did, man. This the best one. This the best one. What you talking about? He said his granddad used to get drunk, right? He said granddad had a horse. He said his granddad would get drunk and fall off the horse at the shot house.
Yeah.
So the horse would come all the way back to the house, and they said they would hear a bunch of noise out front of the house, and they'd go out there, said the horse would be out there. They said they look at the horse, said the horse just be looking at him, and it'd be thumping the ground. They said they look at the horse and say, granddaddy drunk? They said, like, said the horse just start hitting the ground and nodding his head. Then they said they'd tell the horse, take us to granddaddy. They said the horse would start walking and take him to where he was, man. They'd pick him up and put him on the horse, and the horse bring him back. I banned him from my house. I went from the Jeff Frank and Jesse James story to that one, man. I quit, man. I'm done, man.
Man, look. Ain't funny. Boy, we got to take
it. I didn't run over cross country now. We come to Alabama to Town Creek. Really, man.
Man, we got to take a quick break, man, because
Jesse James on the way.
I can't even get it out, man.
That's a true story. He told me.
Now,
I know it ain't true.
You gotta take a quick break, man, and let Jesse pay these bills, man.
You want Frank and Jesse? You don't want Jesse.
Coming to you live from ABS Studio, man. Listen, we started having this stuff go on YouTube Live, man. And if people start seeing what we do backstage, it's going to be so funny, man. That's your song, ain't it? Huh? There you go. Hey.
Oh, man.
This is how we do.
They should have brought that out when I used to be in the CC with my shirt off. That
You and Funny Man was in the CC.
Yeah, man. That was it there, man.
Man, what's the CC, man?
This used to be the club in Tuscaloosa.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
What they call that?
Citizen Club.
Legendary. Citizens Club.
Hey, I don't know about that one, Trent. That might have been, you know what I mean? Hey, you know about that one?
No.
Oh, okay. All
you
right.
You sound like the Post.
Right. I'm like,
why the man tell you we were so bad and that man turned into a church now?
Oh, man.
Yeah, it did.
I only
experienced 1 year, my freshman year, of Stillman of the CC, but man, what a legendary venue, brothers.
Used to go up.
Listen, man.
Oh, man, we used to go up, in, out.
Damn it, about
we used to go, bro.
They had a dance floor. They had a stage with a dance floor up there, man.
Oh, yeah. What you used to do up there?
Hey, baby. Once you got on top of the stage, then your shirt came off. And that bad boy, baby. The best drinks in the building was Long Island.
Yeah, oh,
they
man.
Came in mason jars.
What?
Mm. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You get your two big mason jars.
That's what I was about to bring up, the mason jars. Yeah. Y'all got to understand, it was about almost a 10-minute ride. Still, it was out in the woods.
Yeah, it was out in the ruins. It was in the woods.
Yeah, it was in the 70s.
Oh, that was a Ray's juke joint. The boom boom room. Ray's boom boom room.
Cottondale, man.
Man.
Now, it wasn't in Cottondale.
Y'all weren't scared to go out there?
Huh?
Y'all weren't scared to go out there?
For what?
I don't know, man.
Man, we pull up out there, man. Hit it again, baby. Pull up on me. We couldn't call nobody, so you had to just pull up. There you go.
Right.
We couldn't call nobody. We had no cell phone.
Yeah, to be honest, man, that was a time, like, before everybody had a gun. First they was going to have them, was going to fight. Now, the owner used to have a sawed-off. His stuff got wild, but it would just be fighting. Nobody was shooting like that back then.
But see, Shem didn't want the problem. Shem used to come in that boy, man, like Dollar Bill off of the player club.
Trouble.
He come in there, man, with them white, fresh, white suit on, and them white Stacey Adams on, man, with the SA on the side of the buckle. Yeah, baby. It was all the property. Funny man, remember? Shem used to be the cleanest club owner in the world, man. And we come through that
yeah,
door.
He did.
Man, until, I don't want you guys
until y'all
no
start
trouble.
Trying to fight, boy.
Yeah,
he got a, you know, shoot up in there.
Yeah, and then that switch up and go to Tim. Couldn't get no grip in them faces, man, trying to break up no fight, man.
Oh, man.
remember, Kim, was it right beside it? Was it Frozen Paradise? What was the name of it?
It had a lot of different names. I knew it as the Prime Choice, though.
There it is. That's it. Prime Choice. That's mm-hmm. it. Yeah. They missed a good day, funny man.
They really did, man. It's hard to describe, but y'all really missed out, brother.
Man, that sounds like funny, man. We had Statewide used to come through there, man.
Hey, was
Statewide was Uncle Luke coming through there? Coleman, yeah,
the Two Nasty Crew. Uncle Luke coming through there, the Two Nasty Crew.
Yeah, they came through there. Yeah.
He probably did. Two
I know it's too loud. I'm just trying to see what you're going to catch in Miami. Oh, man. So.
Statewide and all that good stuff, man. We had Frat Row. Y'all missed it, man. We ain't cutting about a spring game.
Oh, y'all had Frat Row.
Yeah.
Oh, we ain't had no Frat Row.
Yeah, we had Frat Row.
Frat Road?
Row. Row.
Row.
All
oh,
row. Row. All oh, yeah, yeah. We, yeah, we, yeah, we, yeah,
we, I mean, but you know, our frat houses is.
We had frat rows, and now it's just mansions everywhere.
Yeah. Oh, no, we have rows. We had one. What? One over behind the dorm, baby. All the black freak houses was on that one stretch.
Oh, yeah, we still had that. We only had four back, though. We had the Kappas, yeah. Then you had the Deltas, then you had the Omegas back there.
Yeah.
And which one?
At a time, like he telling you, they was all right there together.
Yeah, that's how it was.
For some reason, just for some reason, my frat brothers behind the dorm was the only frat that the football team hated.
Yeah. Right, and we used to just fight,
man,
every weekend.
Who used to get into it with? Was it Alphas? Was it? No, it wasn't the Alphas. It was the Q's. We had gotten to that big old fight before, right before I had left.
Yeah.
Oh, man. It was crazy.
I wouldn't fight with none of them. They were having good parties. I needed to be in the party. I come out of that bad boy. They come out. Who all in there, Langham? I said, you know me. I get there. I'll be instigated. Then I say, your girl told you she was going home this weekend, right? he said, yeah. I said, she in there because I just.
Man, what happened was it was a mistake for real. And so one of the cues was it was a pajama party. And you know, all the sports used to be together. Listen, no, it wasn't on us. It wasn't on us. And so one of the girl basketball players was dressed, you know, as a dude. Well, you know, she had her stuff on. She looked like a dude. Mm-hmm. One of the guys was stepping, and you know, it was real drunk, and he was trying to fight the girl. I'm like, hey man, that's a female. And you know, me saying it, and I had Big Nudie with me.
Oh man, Nudie. Johnson Fowler, man, everybody.
I had Big Nudie with me. And dude put his hand up to me like this, and Nudie slapped it down. And when he did that, my brother came over.
Oh man.
And they cleared out that house.
Did Nudie have his gold tooth in?
Yeah, that's when he had them goals in, baby. That he had that Mobile style goals in. So you know how that was.
I remember the
and
first.
And we all had polo boots on that night too.
Did the gold two have a star in it?
I don't know. He had the two heel, the two up top, the two on bottom on them vein teeth.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Nudie was that.
Yeah, he ain't had no true gold tooth, but he had that star in that gold.
I feel like he did. I feel like he had a design at one point.
Yeah.
I remember the first time my freshman year orientation. Freshman year orientation, you walk in. First two dudes I see is Jarek.
Oh, it's my Tank Waterhead.
Yeah. Jarek Williams. And Nudie, Joseph Fowler. Now, I'm 5'10", 170 pounds on soaking wet at this point.
Mm-hmm.
I see these two dudes. I'm like, man, what I done got into from? I mean, Jarek, what? 6'1",
6'2",
200 some pounds. Nudie, Johnson was
265, 270 for real.
Yeah.
Nudie was huge, man.
Yeah, I used to avoid Nudie.
Like,
when I was on the scout team, no way.
Like, Nudie was huge.
No way.
So, speaking of your freshman year.
Yeah.
The first time this man got in my car.
And
Hold on, let me turn the live off.
Turn the live on. Keep the live on. Hey, funny man, the first time he got in my car, I had me old Durango. I was doing it, baby. That's the same car that Tim Cody had messed up at the drive-thru because I told him don't let my window down.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna go back up.
Yeah, later we messed up. On
yeah,
that road,
yeah, right? That thing messed up. And I had the cardboard boxes inside of it. And so I picked them up on the corner. I would think I might have been going to Brian. It was early, too. I don't know how he ended up being drunk at this time. That man crawled into my back seat. And I said, you good, young boy? Yeah, T-Rich, I'm good. He just crawled into the back seat. I ain't say get in the car. I'll just make sure you was all right. I said, man, I'll take you to the dorm, man. He crawled in the back. I said, we here, man. I went into study hall, come back out. He's still in the back. So he had to be back there about 2 hours, man.
Yeah, so, getting that nap in. You know how it go, man.
I don't know what they gave him that day. Wasn't no Bud Light.
that was Bud Strong.
Yeah.
Real strong, man.
Heavy.
They gave him some of that hoop. Heavy. It gave him
yeah.
If he slept for 2 hours in the back seat, he asked him.
I tell you how funny that story is. I don't even remember. He had told me. He told me that a couple weeks back. I said, bro, I ain't gonna lie. I don't even remember that, big bro. I don't.
Man, we had so much fun at Bama, man.
Yeah. What were some of your just standout memories like? Like being there. You know, I feel like for you, you know. You were just, me being there looking from the inside of, you know, the football team and all that stuff. I'm like, you know, man, how did he, you know, what did you find it hard to carry yourself to be a normal kid per se? Because we all get there. We 18 years old.
Yeah, it was different for me, man. Because, you know, like my second year, I had to move off campus early.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't go
right in.
Nah, it wasn't. I had to keep them doors locked at that dorm.
Bro, yeah,
yeah. See what I mean?
Exactly.
And old Ed Simpson used to let people in the dorm. Man, look, I got some of these stories about Ed. But, yeah, man, I had to move off campus, man, and I moved by Bryan High School. So if you came to my house, you had to have an invite. You weren't just coming out there.
You living in Birmingham.
Yeah, for real. I bought a Mercedes exit.
Right. You living in basketball.
Right.
But man, look, it was different, man. We gotta take a quick break. Smitty keep put playing the song, like, man, y'all playing with me, y'all playing my time.
So Smitty, we're gonna pull up on you.
Yeah, I know you're gonna pull up on me. We're gonna take a quick break real quick, man. We're gonna get right back to that question. I got a couple questions to ask you before you get off, because I know you gotta get ready to go too.
Let's do it.
But, man, we'll be right back. We're going to let Caleb play these bills.
I love my old man.
Live from ABX Studios in downtown Birmingham, The Ropes with TR3.
Caleb, man, I'm proud of you, bro. I don't even know what else to say. I mean, honestly, just watching you over the past couple of years chase after your dreams and turn them into a reality, man, it's been awesome to see. And, man, I know the Lord has awesome things in store for you, man. But, bro, I just wanted to tell you that I'm proud of you, man. Love you.
Wow. I'm like, yo, man, that's awesome, bro.
Yeah, man.
He called in?
Yeah, yeah. He left a message earlier, man. I told him you were coming up here, man.
That's what's
he
up, man.
He
want to
give you the roses, man.
Yeah, that made my day right there. I'm like, that sounds just like Mark. Man, that's love, man.
Man, when you hear stuff like that, man, from your siblings and stuff, man, especially your big brother, man, I know they have been, like, leaders for you.
Sure.
Like, and, I mean, you know, everything your dad has done, it's been great. But, you know, to have them brothers to lead that way. Like, because I'm the baby, just like you is.
Mm-hmm.
I think you are the baby. No.
Yeah, I'm the baby boy.
Yeah, you the baby boy. Yeah.
Yeah.
So to have that, like, it's different. Like, man, because all y'all done conquered a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure.
Because I tell anybody, bro, like, to walk on Alabama, and, like, I seen you go through it. Like, you walked on it, Bama, bro. Yeah, and it's, like, and you can tell, am I lying? Like, to walk on Alabama, I feel like you can conquer anything. Like, it is tough.
It is.
Like, yeah. Especially, I know when y'all was playing, because, you know, y'all ain't have shoestrings and anything. Y'all ain't have face masks. At the time,
you know, in order for us to get a new jock strap, we had to cut it a little bit and make it break on us. Make it break on us at practice. We come in, one strap hanging down, and they had to give you another one in, man.
Oh, man.
But, man, you know, I know when I talked to bro earlier, man, they was mad that they couldn't be on the show.
Yeah, right.
But, man, because I know they all had, you know, he had something with his wife to do tonight, man. But he was like, bro, I'm so proud of that, man.
Yeah, honestly, man, like, I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to go. I didn't want to go walk on. I had a few offers.
Yeah, you was about to go to UCLA, right?
I was thinking about going out there. I was thinking about going Clemson. I was thinking about going a couple of different places because I came out of high school playing corner. Like, I went through some BS my senior year, man, where I actually tried to leave Briarwood my senior year. And it was funny because I quit the team about 2 days too late before I could have went to Spain Park. A lot of people don't know that. But, yeah, I quit about 2 days too late before the deadline when I would have been able to go over there and play. So I ended up staying, reconciling. One of the best decisions I really ever made because I had a coach that I didn't really get along with on offense. And so at the time, Mike Forrester, our defensive coordinator, was like, man, just come play defense, man. So, you know, at that time, high school, it's like, you just an athlete. So it's like, all right, I'll figure it out. So the last, like, seven games of the season, I played corner. And I had two of the best corners, you know, to come through Alabama in my house. So I'm like, all right, we gonna figure it out. You know, then we had Unk too. You know, he used to be out there. So, man, it was a thing that was challenging for me as just a young man. Like, to
because, that's crazy, bro. I don't mean to cut you off. That's like you just said two of the best corners to come through Alabama. Like, I didn't even realize. Like, that's still a, you know, that's just processing. Like, your dad and your brother is like some of the two best athletes as far as cornerbacks that possibly say that came through Alabama. Like, I mean, you throw Unk in there too. I mean, but I'm talking about like just in your household though. That's crazy.
Yeah. We had this conversation the other day, Antonio. We was like, bro, it hadn't been a corner since Simeon left that didn't have over 10 picks in they 4 years there.
Right.
And it's, you know, the game's changed, but a lot of times, you know, you sit and look, you like, but what really has changed? Like, because you really recruiting, I mean, bro, you think about Pat. Pat and Simeon in the same corner.
Yeah.
Prototype. That's what you want. 6'1", long. Pat might be a little bit taller than Simeon, but as far as, like, prototype corner, that's what you want. But, you know, a lot of these guys ain't going to get them balls like y'all did, you know, back in the day. So, but yeah, man, like, I don't know. I think that instills some confidence in me enough to at least accept Coach Saban's, you know, walk-on invite. So, and my dad had told me, he said, look, after what I went through at Tampa Bay, them 4 years, losing all them games, and he was balling.
Yeah.
He like, bro, you do not want to go to a losing program. And you don't want to go somewhere where they not, you know what I'm saying, you're not playing for a real leader. Like, one of the things that I instinctively knew about Coach Saban when I went there and sat with him is that, oh, this man is invested in this university.
Yeah.
Like, he gonna be here. So for me, it wasn't something that I'm like, all right, I'm gonna just go here and you know, this man like don't really, you know, give a damn, to be frank. Like, you know, but I really trusted him. Him and my dad have a great relationship. I went, and bro, that was the best 4 years for Caleb's life. When you wanna talk about just the adversity of going and being at Alabama, bro, like, a lot of people don't know, bro, that I went there for 4 years, bro. And, bro, when I say this, people be like, ain't no way. Bro, I went there for play three seasons. And, bro, I had never even touched the field, bro. Zero payoff of what I'm going through every day at practice during the week. So I'm getting, you know, it's like that. But what you gonna do, bro? It's like you gonna quit, you gonna leave, you gonna do this or that. So by the time my junior year came, I was really thinking like, I gotta figure out what I want to do with my life, bro. Like, because I have nothing here that's gonna transpire really in this arena, like playing football. So I'm like, all right, what is it gonna be? I'm gonna be, you know, like, am I going to coach? Am I going, you know, what am I going to do? So, you know, I was in my communications class, and then I picked up a minor in television and film. Just, I needed a minor.
Before you get into that, I'm sorry. I do not want to cut this off, but I got to let you pay a couple more bills.
Yeah, that's fine.
And we're going to get right back to it. If you can stay a little bit longer. Man, look. Hey, I love Hollywood, baby.
Good night.
Yeah, he give me chills, man.
Welcome to Hollywood,
man. But, man, we're gonna let Hollywood pay these bills real quick. We're going to let y'all listen to these quick commercials. And we're going to be right back with The Ropes with TR3.
But Woodlawn move, I heard you came home, you started moving chairs and tables and couches. I said, I heard you were diving over couches, over sofas. You were making cuts on chairs and everything. You had came in and rearranged the whole living room, man. Get ready for it, man. Is it true?
Listen, man. I can neither confirm nor deny.
Anybody start like that?
You know,
it's true.
You know what's so funny about that, man, is... Is oh, that was actually so. Get this.
You can't even get it out.
There's a parallel story.
I told you, man.
There's a parallel story to that one, but you know, yeah, right.
Josh,
you want the truth,
me.
Man. Look, so you know,
take a shot of his teeth.
Right. Get you a little sip of that. So. It was interesting, like, to kind of transition out of what I was saying before the break. Like, I'm trying to figure out what I want to do, man. And I knew, I'm like, look, I just thought in my head, okay, I done won two national championships on the team or helped the team, contributed to them winning two national championships. So, and you know it's more than that, right? It's more than the ball. And
so saying with that, and not to cut you off, people that don't realize, like, to walk on Alabama or to be a water girl or a trainer, like, every piece to that puzzle matters. And that's a big problem this year, I think.
Yeah.
Like, I still want to know if he put the helmet in his pants on and he lowered his head on the wall and on the door and bounced off of the board and that up. He had to do some whole lot of auditioning, man, to get that man.
I did.
Tony Nathan was real deal, man, so he had to run over some stuff, man. I don't know if he was bumping cars and everything to get out there for him. But I need to know about the audition, man.
Listen,
get them a nephew.
I'll tell you this. Those 4 years, three seasons at Alabama was my audition. And I'll tell you what, man, because when I ended up not playing that senior year, and my dad thought that we had talked about going to South Alabama and playing for Coach Jones. Because Coach Jones and my dad's good buddies, and Tim was like, man, yeah, go down there. Blah, blah, blah.
Oh, and Tim was back at school coaching too,
yeah,
right?
Tim was back coaching. So I'm like, I'm having that conversation with my brothers. This is how funny life is and how funny, like, it is having brothers and sisters in a household. Like, I'm having this conversation with my brothers about football, what I might do, and maybe go to South Alabama. I can play me a year, whatever. On the other hand, I lived with my sisters all through college.
Yeah.
So they see me every day coming home with the workload on your shoulders, and they, you know,
frustrated.
Frustrated. It's like me. It's like I had three wives at home in college, right? So I come home and they seeing all of that. And I remember distinctly my oldest sister Leah was like, bro, you not happy.
That's my dog, man.
Yeah, Leah. I'm like, you not happy. She's like, so whatever decision you know inside is going to lead you to that road of fulfillment, whatever it is, you need to do that. So
that for me was stepping away from ball and just being like, all right, let me figure it out. And long story short, that road led me to pursuing acting. And
so you said your brother was telling you what?
Oh yeah. Well, Tim was basically like, yeah, man, like South Alabama, that'll be a good move for you. Go down there and da 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 da.
Speaking of your brother, Tim, Coach Jeremiah, how you doing?
Look at his face.
We're well, Trent.
Oh, what's there up? He is. Y'all just full of surprises tonight. What's up, Dad?
Hey, what's happening, boss?
How you feeling? Hey,
man, we're excellent. Hey, Trent.
Yes, sir. How you doing?
What's up, big bro?
Excellent, man. Doing.
You know that's old Langham there, man. That's Langham. It's
oh
me.
My goodness.
Oh yeah. Uh-huh. It's a family affair.
Here we go.
It's a family affair. It's Miss Lisa over here. It's Caleb, and we got Reggie calling in too. Reggie Ragland, he on there too, man. So, man, Reggie, how you doing? I'm invite Reggie Reggie's in too. Reggie, how you doing?
Tired.
Oh, I know he tired. Look, he can't even get the words out. Yeah. I'm going to speak it for him. He's tired. But, Coach, how you doing, man?
We're doing well. We're doing well, man. Thanks for asking. Thank y'all for having us on. I didn't know Caleb was going to be on your show.
Yeah, I had to come steal him from the family for a little bit. I had to come spend some big brother time with him, too, man. So, okay. I had to, you know, keep it in the family. Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir, man. Look, it's always a blessing to see you, man. You know, when your daddy get on the phone or you start talking to your daddy, you start talking a little different.
Right. Mm-hmm. Hey, dad, hey, what's going on? Yeah, you know.
Man, look, see, Coach called me one time.
Y'all that new school say, man, big bro, we talk different. We on the phone. See, we the old school, you know what I'm saying? We that school you chew rocks and stuff, man. Y'all, we ate dirt growing up, you know, y'all. Y'all, oh, stuff God, like that don't go. Do right. Y'all, we get grass in our mouth. We just go ahead and wash it on down with a ball with some water. And we keep going. Y'all got to go rinse your mouth out and all that stuff. You know, man. You know what I mean, big bro?
No respect from anyone.
Oh, man. Pop, you there?
Yeah.
Oh, there
he
is.
Don't tell that man. You got Langham on there, man. You got to have me on there with Langham. You got to have me come in.
That's gonna be real interesting.
Oh yeah,
we can do a little DD talk.
There we go, right now.
Whenever you're ready to come in, you know this is a B sci-fi fan platform right here, baby.
I'm gonna hold you to that now. This month is a good month for me.
You can come in tomorrow.
You heard Miss Lisa, our producer. She said you can come in tomorrow.
Okay, let me check my calendar, and I'll let you all know.
Hey, big bro, I got one question for you. Just one quick question, because I couldn't never get the real answer out of my nephew over here. I need to know how many holes you had to patch up in the wall, how many chairs and new sofas you had to buy when he was auditioning for Woodlawn. I heard he was in there running all over all the furniture, man, diving off the top, off the counters and stuff, man, like he's diving over the top. Is that true, big bro?
Bang on, man. I came home one day. Man, the kitchen just was tore up, bro.
I knew my big brother telling the truth, baby. I knew.
So why were you doing all of that? Like, you was trying to get stronger?
He was auditioning. He was moved all the furniture. Got him a little bootleg camera crew. Yeah, they filming it. I'm like, what are you up to?
Oh, man. Hey,
he ain't gonna tell his dad.
He kept all of that close. Hey,
you know all the boys had iPhone. He had Justin Shade. What the other one name?
Right.
Matt Blair. Yeah, man. He had all the boys over there filming.
Yeah.
Oh,
had bootleg crew here, man. Hey,
we had to get the job done, man. You know, nobody down here know nothing about that filming, man. I had to make it do what it do, man. You know.
What kind of cameras did they have?
Man, I don't know, man. JVC, y'all know. Stuff they don't even make no more. Hey, bro. We down at the thrift store trying to find some stuff, man. You know. At that time, the iPhones really weren't good quality.
Nah, I don't think iPhone had a camera then.
We could get the truth out of big bro before you came on.
Man, I come in there. They got all the windows patched up, covered up. Man, what y'all got over these windows, man? What y'all trying to do?
They had to get that white drop in the back off.
Yeah.
so they won't get no glare on the camera.
Oh, man. Oh, man, that's too funny.
Oh, God.
Oh, my goodness. That cracked me up.
Tell
right
me
there.
The truth. I knew no, Big Brother.
Hey, but Langham, he should have told y'all about how when he called me from down there in Tuscaloosa, telling me, breaking the news to me, he was going to quit the football team. Now that was a kicker, boy. I started loading my gun on that one.
You going to do what now?
Big brother, yeah. Big brother, did you tell him you had no bed there for
him? No, boss. I was loading my 380, putting buttons in it. I mean, you ain't no Castille. We're going to take you out.
You was going to have to go check birth certificate, what you been?
Yeah.
Oh, that's too funny, man.
Yeah. Yeah, bro, I was getting ready to go jack him up, and I tell you, you know, as he was talking, man, I was just fuming and getting hotter and hotter and hotter. And he said something that God used to just totally diffuse me, and that was, he said, "Dad, acting is my dream." And when he said that, hey, it's my dream, God said, "You can't touch that."
That's right.
Mm. Yeah.
Just like football was my dream growing up, and that's what God used. My dream was to play at Alabama. And I told all my high school buddies that when I was coming up. And so when he said that, God said, "Hey, you can't touch that. That's precious."
Hmm. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I know you're proud of him, man. Because I'm proud of him. Hey, I remember that. Oh, I ain't going to tell you about that story. He crawled in the back of my car.
Yeah, we're going to skip that one. We're
going to skip that one.
Yeah. Oh, man.
I'm proud of him because he had a dream and he pursued it. He did all of the due diligence to make it happen. And that's, you know, we live in a world today, a lot of times you can go on social media and see people, what we call instant success, but they don't see the due diligence, the hard work that comes with you. You know, you guys know what I'm talking about. And so I'm proud that he was willing to do the due diligence to make it happen.
Hey, Big Bro, I knew he was the real deal. I called it several of those episodes. I knew he was the real deal when he ran LL Cool J down and ran by him in one of the episodes. he read it. He made it now. He went past LL.
Hey, now, man, you can't be messing with LL, bro. You know, we grew up on my boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah, man, it's, you know, it's been very cool, and I think my dad will agree with this. Like, it's been really cool to kind of, you know, as I've immersed myself in this business, it's been cool to, like, you know, kind of switch lanes. You know, dad still being very involved at Alabama, but switching lanes into this, you know, entertainment industry. And I mean, my dad's, you know, he's telling the truth, man. He really was like, "Man, you know, we don't know much about this, but we trust in that, like you're saying, it's your dream and that God's going to see you through it." And it's been really awesome to see how my parents have received that and how they cheer me on and watch the show. They're genuine fans of the show, you know, just not because, you know, their baby boy's on it, but, you know, they really tune in to NCIS LA, you know, Sunday nights when they get a chance. And so it's been fun, you know, man. But because I it's really interesting. Like, when you was asking me something earlier, Trent, I was like thinking, I'm like, man, like, I could have went a million different paths.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But, you know, God always got that one for you, man.
Yeah. I'll be watching your show too, man. I'll be on top of.
You know?
Look, we're going to take a quick break, and Smitty playing that music now, man. We're going to have Reggie Ragland on there too, man. We got, if you could stay on there one more segment, Coach, if you can, and Tim, if y'all could. I know I'd be, like I said, I wanted to get little bro his flowers, man. I know you're proud of him, but if you could, we're going to come back with Reggie Ragland too, man. We're going to ask a couple more questions for all three of y'all, because I know y'all being a big part of his life and still is. We're going to let your son pay these bills for these quick commercials real quick.
He's gonna pay for the whole segment.
Yeah, the whole segment. We'll be right back with the ropes with TR3. Right.
You can do that.
are back with The Rope with TR3. I'm your host, the one and only Trent Richardson, and we have in studio Super Bowl. I mean, no, not in studio. We got over the phone, Super Bowl winner via phone, one and only Reggie Ragland. Reggie, how you doing, man?
Man, I'm doing good, big dog. You know, fresh off of Victory Monday. You know, got so much time, worked out this morning. Ate good, look good, feel good, you know?
How you doing, fold them up?
Oh, man, you know, I'm good. You know, Thanksgiving treated me well. You know, I gained 14, 15 pounds, but, you know, I released it all already.
Hey, my kids called in looking for you, too,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, that's why I called you fold them up.
I will fold every single last one of them up. I don't care who their daddy is.
Hey, we got Coach Castille on the phone too now. Yeah, you gotta watch the language now. Hey, Coach, you still on there?
Hey, we still here. Hey, Reg.
Hey, so I'm gonna say this now. Uh-oh. If you wore 19 at Alabama, it's guaranteed to be All American. That's all I'm gonna say.
Uh-oh. I know that's right.
Yeah, that's all I'm gonna say. Yeah.
And Tim, you still on there too?
Tim, are you there?
Tim ain't gonna hang.
Tim, girls yeah, had I'm, about I'm 18 here. Basketball games.
Yeah.
Tim,
so, no, I'm, yeah. I'm here.
Oh,
so, big swole in the house.
That red crack.
See Reggie. So Reggie, you, Caleb, y'all was all there when Tim was out there coaching. So how much, you know, the running back room and the linebacker room kind of go with it. How much did y'all go with it when Tim was there? Because I know he was around Coach Burns. I know, you know, y'all really kind of went at it.
Oh, it was all fun, man. You know, we talked our stuff. We gave it to each other at practice, man, but it made everybody so much better. The competition of things, man, especially when you got your coaches jawing back and forth to it, then your players going back and forth, man, and It made everything fun and it kept everything going. Because just like you know, Caleb know, and Tim know, them practices back then was difficult, man. Yeah. and we had to find ways to get through them. So, man, I'm thankful for all of y'all, man, all the Castiles. Your dad giving the sermons before the game, man. I used to be ready to go. He'd get the clapping and he'd get the pointing that finger. Preach. I knew what time it was.
That's right.
Man, look. Man, Coach, you said you, know, Reggie, you gave with one sermon, man. Chapel,
man, the only thing that bad about him, I couldn't go suit up after I got group fired y'all up.
Coach, hey, that's why us 19 got to stick together.
Yes, sir. Coach, you gave one sermon, and it was about focus. And I think, I don't know, was it at the chapel or was it, I think it was before the season when he used to have the guest speakers come and speak and stuff, and you gave one about focus, man. And I'm telling you, like, that speech right there you gave us made my junior year like what it was. Mm. Like I had to I had a plan. You know what I mean? I had my plan, but I had my goals. I had my rules of, you know, how I wanted to do it, the way I came in and prepared. Like that focus sermon that he gave us, like, it, man, that did everything for me. Cause it was just like, all right, let me rearrange some stuff. Let me move some people around. Okay. I can't do this. You know, I'm staying off campus too. I gotta set an example for, you know, you. I gotta set an example for, you know, the guys that's coming after me. Like, I had to focus up. And then at the time, like we didn't have them NIL deals, and so I had two little girls in school.
You had them. It wasn't legal, but you had them.
Oh my god.
Big bro. Big bro, we were the one who tried to survive. They had them, Big bro. When you were trying to survive off $50 every 2 weeks, they had them, Big bro, didn't they, bro?
Come on, man. They don't know.
They don't know, do they, bro? $50 of that, and you had to.
Hey. To make them mad.
Coach almost cut.
Hey, tell him, bro, I had to play hard. I was able to find somebody to. I could pay them $10. They'll wash my clothes for me, man. I had $40 to buy for 2 weeks.
No, you had to pay nobody to watch. We ain't talking about that. You had to have to wash. You know you had people coming in there and wash your clothes for free. We ain't talking about that.
We have a two wash machines at Brian Hall. He had to go find me a little laundry. I had to find me a little cleaning service.
Big Brother tell them they had the life. Then the Big Brother went, hey, what we got had going on called the vibe.
Live off that $1,500 Pell Grant all year.
Hey, them boys were getting that every month, wasn't it, Big Brother? Oh,
my God. So you know, that changed, like, my junior year or my senior year, because, you know, they started paying us, like, the cost of attendance. So I was getting $1,600, and then the Pell Grant, you know, my folks were making them, so I was getting, like, $2,800. So, you know, I thought I was balling in my little Ford Explorer.
See that? See what I mean, Big Brother?
Yeah,
see what
I mean? Really balling in.
Reggie had all the shoes, all the new sneakers.
See what I mean, man?
Yeah.
Hey, man, hey, man. So you know the reason why, okay.
So the reason I
had all the shoes, right? So you know, in Birmingham, it's a Foot Locker. So I used to know a little chick that worked at Foot Locker there. So she said, put my shoes to the side.
Here we go.
See that? He would get them out the back door a day early. They don't come out till tomorrow, but he getting them the day before, man. Don't wear them till tomorrow night when they drop.
Get me in trouble.
You don't get me in trouble.
Take them shoes.
Man, that's too funny.
So we was on here earlier. We were talking about remedies.
And
this young lady over here, she said when they was younger, they used to put what around y'all neck?
Sardines around our head.
Because you had what?
Monk.
Big Bro, you ever heard of that?
What was
she
that?
Caught up, she said she caught up her cousin, and she said back then they used to take the juice from the sardines and they used to pour it in the diaper. When the cloth diaper.
cloth diaper.
Yeah. You know the old school dog, the cloth.
And the sardines.
They used to pour the juice and the sardines off in a little, when no cloth diapers, and they used to wrap it around their face when they had the mumps.
Mm-hmm.
You ever heard of that, Big Bro?
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah.
Oh, hey. Okay.
I love you. Thank you. They thought I was lying.
Yeah. I told them about I told them about the talent, the fat, and the little cup with the rag. She used to heat that little rag up, rub it on your chest.
Oh, yeah, but I heard, we grew up with that sardine deal.
No, I'm gonna tell you a good one too, though. If you cut an onion up, and I say if you like got a cold or you want to detox yourself, you put it in your sock overnight, it'll pull the toxins out your body.
Suck it all out. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You cut the onion up and put the sock on.
Put the onion in the sock, what? And then it sucks out all the toxins in your body. You can also take onions and cut it in half, put them around your house, keep them for 2 days. It will suck all the viruses and diseases out of your house.
Man, my head would be hurt. I have.
Only for 2 days, you won't smell it.
Man, listen, I get migraines. I ain't dealing with no onion.
It'll take away that.
Mm-mm.
Right, probably.
Yes. It will.
Yeah, you playing.
Because by the time you wake up, the onion going to change colors from pulling the toxins out your body.
It'll turn black.
I got to make sure I wake up. Because y'all, listen, I ain't playing with y'all.
What is it? Any type of onion? Red onion? Yellow onion? Red onion?
Yeah.
Well, they said.
My grandmother uses red onion.
They said red onion is healthy for you. Why would I put them in my sock when I can eat them? I wouldn't put
that. It has to be raw. Indeed, that's why you don't eat onions at a buffet, because those onions suck up all the germs in the air.
I didn't know
y'all don't understand that. See, I'm teaching y'all some stuff. Just about football.
Well, next time I have a good sandwich and I want some red onions on them, tell them to cut that boy fresh. Bring it out here. You cut that boy.
Exactly.
Don't give me the onion head out there all day. It pulled everything everybody said out of here today, man. Every time I was about to open it up, it was a little bit of red onion got a little bit of. So that rag next time you in Vegas, I need to get that burger with the red onions. If it been laying on that buffet all day. You need every gambler that came in there, boy. Every call.
Right. That's what I'm saying.
But he's not lying.
Hey, good thing I ain't going to the buffets out here.
Big Bro, you heard that too?
Oh, God.
About the red onion?
I ain't never heard of that one.
Oh, okay. All right.
It worked.
Well, I guess we're going to let Caleb play some more bills. I hear that music going again. We're going to try to dissect this onion stuff, because I'm telling you, my homeboy told me the other night his wife had the flu or cold or something. he said she had onions all around. He said, man, my head been hurting ever since then, man. Mm. And this, mm-hmm. My headaches are sensitive. I done been hitting the head too many times. I ain't but, doing it. Ain't no but.
You don't put them right under your nose.
Well, under my nose.
Listen, well, it sounds like I to me you need don't. To put some red onions in your pillow up under the bottom part of it. Just know it won't be on the cooler side. Cooler than the other side.
You have me smelling my horns and stuff now, cuz.
Well, just know if you're sliding on that pillow, they're going to pull it out of the pillow.
Now we're gonna take a quick break, man. We'll be right back.
Conversation going all the way to the left
with the Rose with TR3.
Jacobs with running room right up the middle. Jacobs is on his way. The Raiders are going to win this game.
You have the one and only Reggie Ragland, Super Bowl winner, Antonio Langham, Caleb Castile, NCIS. 30 seconds of 911.
Man, that is too funny.
Listen, it was seconds. So funny because I had asked your pops. I said, you know, what's his next project? He said, Caleb just did about 8-9 episodes with 911, but I think he was talking about
NCIS.
Yeah.
And so he went looking on 911.
Hey, I was ready for that thing to come out.
You got killed,
what? Immediately, I'm reading the script. Wow. I'm like, hold on, I'm only on the first page.
Hi, you know, pop.
Right? You watch the shows about the crime scenes. I'm the crime scene.
It was chalk. the very first episode.
Hey, it was too bad even chalk.
Listen, he got slung out the dog at all. He was at the fair. Yep. Him and old girl. He got. Uh-huh. Like he gets slung out the dog at all thing.
Yeah, got slung out the roller coaster.
And so I'm telling everybody, I'm like, hey man. My little brother, man, he'd be one of the co-stars on 911. I'm telling everybody. Mom Duke's at the house. We back in Florida, too. We all at the house. And got the kids gathered around. I'm like, look, there you go right there.
And there you go.
Shoot. Ricky!
What's your mom say that? Well, let me go finish Della.
Yeah. He was like, Hillary, will you marry?
Yeah, let me go finish Della.
Oh, my God.
And he was just like.
You sure he going to be back?
I think he lived, y'all. I'm telling you. I know he lived.
Right. You're trying to explain. Yeah. He lived. No, I'm pretty sure.
He'd be back.
Right. I don't know how they going to pull that storyline off.
Man.
Hey, but, you were on it. You can say you were on it, though.
You know, it's funny because it's kind of like, I feel like rite of passage into my industry where it's like, you're going to die at least once on TV. You know what I mean? Luckily, I ain't have to sit there and do the whole, you know, you know what I mean?
I was quick. Oh, you hear me?
Slow down, man. This was quick and painless.
It was so crazy because they ain't even show him just dying. They just show him just
flung out.
So I ain't even get to see the.
Oh my God. Right. So he falling the flyaway. That's me right there.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's me. Yeah.
But man, look, I'm so proud of you, bro.
Thanks, man.
Man. And I know you proud of him, man.
You want to get to Tim? Let Tim say something before we get out?
Tim, I think Tim got off there, man. Tim, he laid back, man. He gonna give you 30 seconds and he up out of there. He ain't with all that talking and stuff, man.
Yeah, his girls had basketball games tonight.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Talia had a game tonight. Talia had a game tonight.
Oh, yeah.
Not so long ago, I ran into Tim. We was at a tournament and I think our girls played against each other or something like that.
Yeah.
But man, that's crazy. Like the, because I know we was talking about the NCIS. Mm-hmm. Like, I was asking, did you have any other projects going on? You was like, man, we film so much.
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of hard.
Yeah.
Like, how long do y'all film, like, them seasons?
I mean, our season starts in July and ends around March or April. So, it's like, depends on if we do 20 episodes or 22 episodes. But, I mean, it's 8-9 months of work, 5 days a week, 12 hours a day. you know, it's serious, bro. And you know, I really didn't realize what I was getting myself into. That's why I told you, man, like the biggest audition for me and the biggest kind of thing that got me ready for that level job, that job was them years at Bama, man. Mm. You know, just the mental toughness. You feel me? Just being able to be focused, like you said, focus on the job. And people be asking me, you know, like you said, what's new with you, man? I'm like, man, I'm trying to just, you know, maintain and build on what's in my hands right now. So for me being on this show, man, it's been a huge just learning curve. It's been a great thing for me, even learning how to manage money, how to take a huge financial jump and still, you know, have your head on. And which I know, you know, you guys know what that's like, bro. And but I think a lot of that, man, just comes from who you are and your focus. But it's also a lot of times we'd be like, oh, messed up on that. You know, but yeah, man.
So tell me this, in the future, like, do you see yourself writing some stuff, like producing some stuff on your own?
Yeah. So, speaking of producing, I've produced, currently producing a documentary about Alabama football. And we got a nice group of producers on that team. And basically what we've done is we are telling kind of the definitive story of the university as well as but through the lens of the football team, but even deeper through the lens of the first black players that integrated. So we start basically kind of about in 68, 69, 70, 71, in that kind of 4-year frame when the real conversation started happening about, because Coach Bryant tried to integrate the team in the 40s. He tried to integrate football in the 40s, bro, college football. But a lot of people don't realize how long it took. It took them about 20 years for it actually to happen. Yeah. So we start there with Wilbur Jackson, John Mitchell, those guys, and
y'all did a real good job. And Coach, thanks to you for the Night of the Legends.
Yeah, Night 11.
Night of the Legends, man. And I think that was through your foundation and Coach Foundation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was through my dad's Jeremiah Castile Foundation, and Dad and them crushed that. But that dinner and my dad's idea is what was the spark. That was the catalyst for this documentary. Mm-hmm. So it's actually, Marlon Humphrey's one of our executive producers. Marlon wrote me a big old check to go get that done. So, it's something I'm super excited for. It's going to shake the college football world up, because it's a lot of things about the university and the football team and the South in general that a lot of people are not aware of, and we air all the laundry.
Yeah.
When is it coming out?
We don't have a release date yet. We'll have it packaged and sold by Q1, first quarter of the year, and then we're aiming though to premiere it before fall season 2023.
We gotta have you come back.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, we're gonna have a big premiere in Birmingham for it.
So tell me this: will it be like episodes, or will it just be a documentary movie or a movie?
Long form doc. So it'll be about a 90-minute runtime. Mm-hmm. It's really Alabama's last dance, and it's really powerful, bro. Because, man, some of the stories, man, that I heard, and one of the questions that I was kind of getting to earlier, about just, I cannot imagine this, bro. Like, you come out of high school, you're a superstar, you're trying to make this huge decision to go to whatever university is going to service you best. And for us, it's like, bro, how they felt about my skin tone never came into that equation. Think about how heavy that is as an 18, 19-year-old kid. I can't even imagine that, bro. Yeah. Like, my decision is, do they want my black behind there or not?
Yeah.
Like, and what's the coach thing about that? What's it like? I'll wrap this up with this. George Pugh told us a story, bro, before they played, I think it was like the 72 or 73 national championship. First national championship Coach Bryant won with black players. And this is just a preview of a lot of the hard truths you will hear in this documentary. George was struggling in a class to stay eligible, and he needed a certain grade on this literature paper, whatever, literature, English, whatever they called it back then. And at the time, bro, they was getting all type of threats before the game. Like, they had folks telling them, like, y'all take y'all black ass up there to play Notre Dame. We gonna kill you, blah, 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 all this stuff, right? You talking about fans of your own team, bro. Like, Alabama fans saying this crazy stuff. And George is like, bro, he had a professor. Obviously knew he was on the brink, right? He got to be eligible to go play this game. And George had just barely missed the score he needed on his paper. And the professor was like, all right, well, here's some errors I noticed. I'll let you write it again. How many times do you think he made George write that paper?
One.
27.
27?
He made George write that paper 27 times. 27 times, bro. 27 times. How bad you want it?
Made him work for it.
Made him go work for it. But not because he believed in George. It wasn't that. It was because he believed in the student. He could be none of that. No, I'm letting you know how I feel about you. And y'all being here, y'all black boys coming to my university, playing on my team and all that.
In other words, you don't get no easy pass.
You know, easy pass.
Oh, no.
You know?
No.
And
good enough was never going to be good enough at that point.
Never. No. It had nothing to do with that. You talking about very intelligent, tough men.
But you know, as black men, as black people in this country and just in general, good enough has never just been good enough for us as people. We've always had to go beyond and above to get a lot of things that we wanted. Like me, I was fortunate. I grew up in Alabama, so I know all about racism and everything like that. I went to a predominantly white institution, school, high school, middle school, all that. And I was fortunate. I had some great teachers to help me out. Like, God rest his soul, I'll never forget this man in my life, Mr. Mitchell. I would stay every day after school with him, white man, every day after school with him, just to pass with a 68 in biology. And that's what I needed in the class to get by. And I had got a 69, 70. And just for him just to, every day, me in the ninth grade, for him just to sit back, and he knows I'm trying. It's one thing about I was dead trying to pass this class, and he knew it. And he was like, Reggie, just stay after school, and I'll help you out. And he helped me get to where I needed to be, man. So can't say that about a lot of guys. Can't say that about a lot of people in the South. But I can say I had some good people around me to help me get me to where I am today.
Yeah.
So I'm thankful for Mr. Mitchell, a white man, to get me through where I had to go. So I'm thankful for him.
Yeah.
But amen 27 to that, bro. Times. 27 times? Come on now.
Yeah, bro.
Come on now.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah, man. And Coach, I don't know if you want to say something to Caleb. I know he got to get up out of here, man. He got a new guy, baby. I'm putting it in the air. He got a new guy, baby. He got to go see, man. So, Coach,
thank y'all for having Caleb on and having me on tonight. And, hey, Trent, we'll I'd like to get on this month and with my brother Antonio, and we can I'd like to come back on. So we'll be in touch.
Anytime you want to come, Coach, just let me know. And we'll text and call each other. And every time you call me, man, I don't say I get scared, but I know it's gonna be a good lesson in it.
Hey, Caleb, love you, bro, man. Appreciate you everything, my guy.
Yeah, man. Hey, Reggie, man, you right down the road a couple hours, man. I'm gonna have to come over there and break some bread with you, bro.
Man, you ain't got no choice, cause as soon as they let me start playing, I'm gonna need you up in there.
That's it. That's it,
just,
man.
Just not at a buffet.
Well, keep the onions away.
There you go. Tell them to cut them off fresh. Let you see them cut them.
That's too good.
Amen. All right, y'all. We're going to take a real quick break. We're going to let Caleb play these last bills before you get up out of here.
Yeah, I'm going to get out of here before I got to write any more checks.
Run back check, yeah, Caleb.
With the ropes with TR3. Quick one, man. I know we're gonna close out real quick. I know we ain't got number 3 minutes, but you have had Reggie Ragland on their Super Bowl winning. You have 1992, the one and only Unc, Antonio, Slick'em Langham. You have had Chris on the keyboards. You have Miss Lisa over here producing these red onions and sardine necklaces and dry pimples. and onions. You have had Coach Castile, Mr. Jeremiah, himself, the originator of the Castiles. That came
the creator.
Through. We had Simeon come on, gave us a good message, man. We had Tim come on, and everybody said they was proud of you, Caleb, man. We definitely appreciate you, man, for stopping through, man. You know, this definitely. Our platform, man. Anytime you want to come through, anything, you got anything coming through, far as your projects, your foundation, your Pops Foundation, man, you already know this the show to get it on out, man. I appreciate you.
Yeah, I appreciate y'all, man. It's been a blast being here, man. And it's really, to be honest, bro, like, it's crazy. I was walking around Tuscaloosa, man, and I was just thinking about, like, just how special that place is to a lot of people and everyone that's been through there and the relationships I've been able to build. And it really is. It really do feel like family, man. Like, you know, like we joke around a lot. I call you big bro, call you unk, stuff like that. But that's the way you feel. Mm. And that environment's kind of curated that. And I'm grateful to be here, man. I'm glad we ran into each other. We got to do this.
Oh, yeah. Most definitely, man.
You know, man. Kelly Hollywood, now he's big words and stuff. Man. Yeah, you know what I'm saying, man. You know what I'm saying?
I'm going to Google it.
I'm going to Google it when I leave here, man. See what that's all about, because, you know, he threw me off, man.
Hello, man.
Look at Lisa. She said, you get on my leg.
Hey, Deputy, he said, you know, we plan on dropping the Q1. I'm lost. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? I don't know what that means either. You know what I'm saying? I had to Google that.
Quarter one.
In Hollywood, I kind of figured that, but I don't know what Q1 is. Q1 started January.
It's January through April. 6 months. That's first quarter.
Yeah. I know 15 minutes, first quarter.
I'm
15
done.
Minutes,
I'm
second
done.
Quarter.
Not
halftime, 15 minutes, right. Third quarter. I'm calling Q1. How many months did it go between Q1 and Q2?
We had a dude on our team, Psycho Rob Woodson. And so Kirby told him, he said, Kirby Smart said, Rob, call out your down a distance. So, you know, he talking to the DB. So, you know, he's supposed to call like fourth and, you know, 13 or something. Rob say, down in distance. Man, we start rolling, man, in the middle of the play. God. We start rolling. And Coach Saban couldn't do nothing but put his head down and start laughing.
Yeah, bro.
Oh, man, we done had a good time, man. Look, y'all come back tomorrow, man. We're going to chop it up tomorrow. We're going to have Reggie back on there. He got off day tomorrow. It's Tuesday. Probably going to have Blake on there. We'll probably get Coach Mike on there. And Langham. Oh, y'all, no, we got the big show tomorrow. We got Hometown Hero.
Yeah.
Oh, everybody in here tomorrow, baby.
Tomorrow we got Q2.
We got Q2.
We got Q2 tomorrow.
Q2 well, look, tomorrow.
I'm done.
So, man.
When to be Q3, you know. Man. Thursday to be Q4, and Friday to be Q5.
Oh,
come
man.
On, sucker.
Man, I'm going to get off here, man. I so appreciate everybody,
much
man.
Love.
I'm signing off, man, with the ropes with TR3.
Can't take him nowhere.
Man.